top probability of becoming a trustee once matching to the residency here is 100%. That being said, my study also shows that Dr. Foley's pretest probability of meeting more than a dozen trustees on any given Friday, also 100%. Our next lecturer was one of my co-chiefs and is currently a well-regarded doctor as well as well-known researcher, and I'm excited to introduce Dr. David Wallace. Dr. David Wallace is assistant professor in the Department of Critical Care Medicine and Emergency Medicine at the University of Pittsburgh School of Medicine. He earned his medical degree from SUNY Downstate and then stayed to complete his residency training here in the EMI program in 2009. Dave then went on to do a critical care medicine fellowship and postdoctoral research training at the University of Pittsburgh and is currently funded by the NIH to study healthcare geography for time-sensitive medical emergencies. So welcome, Dave Wallace.
To be here, it's really an honor. I'm going to stand over here because this is where Dr. Jody was and a little bit of hero worship, I think, is ahead. Really awesome to be back. Awesome to see that Bacon is still its own food group in Brooklyn. That's thank you also for all your patience. I know we've been going over and trying to make this quick. And initially, I was just going to talk about HSR, which is not socket replacement, but it's what I do, health services research. But then I thought I got to leave you with some pro tips. So these are going to be a collection of things I learned in the first year of fellowship at the University of Pittsburgh. So we'll start with HSR. And I don't know if you've heard this before, but if some is good, more is better. And I remember hearing this when I was a med student on his hill. And it was from a surgery resident who I did not like. And it wasn't just because he was calling me short coat. Like, take that bandage off, short coat. Go make me a sandwich, short coat. So I didn't like it for another reason. But I also just thought, obviously, this is far too simplistic. And there's a lot of reasons why this is wrong. So we might think, well, how do we actually think something's good? Or maybe some is good, but it's just coincidentally associated with good in a way that we're not measuring or not anticipating. What if more isn't an option? So these are components of causality, but it's also kind of the fundamental tenets of health services research. And Dr. Sue would probably say, what if some is good and more is toxic? So who is this guy? I'll tell you, this is not Peter Saffer, the creator of CPR from the University of Pittsburgh, but this is Avitas Gonabedian. So this is the thought leader of health services research. And he developed a conceptual model for thinking about quality. And a lot of the talks today have involved bounce backs and lean and Six Sigma. And so I think about quality as well from a research standpoint. But what is quality? We know when we see it, but there's other ways of getting at quality. So you might think about looking at structural elements or process or outcomes. What is this conceptual model? Structure, these are the physical and organizational aspects of providing care. Process, this might be medical practices, protocols, and outcomes, we know what outcomes are, that's a direct impact it has on our patients. And the idea with the conceptual model is that structure leads to process and leads to outcomes. You can measure different pieces of this to try to get at quality. That sounds good, but what would this look like? So structural elements, this might be computerized provider coordination. The locations of hospitals, the locations of EMS depots, where are helipads, those kinds of things. Maybe look at staffing models. Process, well, this will be the timeliness of a diagnosis, whether or not appropriate therapies even, look at care coordination. And outcomes, obviously lots of outcomes. Again, one lead to the next, lead to the next. So when I left here, I graduated from the residency in 2009, and went on to Pittsburgh for 3 years of fellowship. Initially, I was doing some work in staffing, and that led to a number of papers, and this was all, of course, inspired by the great Dr. Obin, who was always in the A side, and it just seemed like Dr. Obin worked every shift. We didn't have a Dr. Obin, but we did have our own problems with the staffing, doing a lot of thinking about nighttime staffing, a lot of thinking about good level providers. The reason I put this up, I'm not going to go into these papers, but it was the first time that I really had my prior where I drunk the Kool-Aid and thought there has to be value to having nighttime intensivists. There has to be value to these other domains. We couldn't find it. So it was really a kind of a losing your religion to become apostolate. But that's good. That's good when you do that, because you don't want to just reproduce your own priors. And so all of this work was when I was finishing up my fellowship and led me into another area, which is regionalized care. And so regionalization is coming. And what is it? Well, the trauma system is really a mature example of regionalized care. We know this. This is organized acute care delivery system with EMS and emergency departments, community, we have some high capacity hospitals. And in our system, well, of course, we would route more of the patients to those systems, EMS or some patients, they're going to end up going to the smaller hospitals. We transfer them. Or if we can't transfer them, we use telemedicine and other technologies to overcome geographic barriers to give that kind of expertise to the smaller centers. And then, of course, the system, in order to be financially viable, there has to be some repatriation where patients are brought back to the smaller hospital, closer to home, closer to where they want to be, when their services match for that hospital. There is really strong conceptual support for this. So this is from New England in 2006 by my mentor at Pittsburgh, Jeremy Kahn. And he found, he made this observation, that if you look at the outcomes of patients that are mechanically ventilated and treated at hospitals that have low volumes, and you compare them to the hospitals that have high volumes, there's a huge quality gap, and it's measured just based on volume. So this is called the volume-outcome relationship. High volume, good outcome. Maybe that makes sense, but what's the linkage there? How do you get just volume to outcome? And of course, you can think about practice making perfect. There's another piece. So we've already heard about Gladwell, and he talked a lot about this idea that practice makes perfect, that superb performance is just associated with calories burned, put the time in. Okay? Talks about the 10,000 hour rule. It's not if you can do it, but it's when you can do it. Selective referral, on the other hand, is the opposite relationship. That good outcomes will drive your volume. And this is obviously the basis of marketing. This is why people put signs up advertising how good they are at things, hoping to attract patients. For critical illness, well, if you have planned critical illness, that sounds crazy, right? But for high-risk surgery, that's what it is. And that makes sense. You would go to the best place. So, okay, that's an example of where outcome drives volume. Unplanned critical illness is, I think, is unlikely because patients, to a very small degree, are going to be choosing directly EMS to bring them to centers based on quality. And then inter-hospital transfers, when a patient is critically ill and then they get moved up the chain, will they get moved to the best hospital? The truth is, it probably doesn't happen. So you have these two competing sides of the puzzle. And you may have thought, but I've been hearing recently that this isn't really whole, and that's true. There are examples of volume outcome going away, and that's actually probably a success, that you can overcome the volume outcome relationship, that you can export best practices, that you can make the smaller center do better. And we struggled with this. So last month, this was sort of 3 years of work. We did a huge systematic review with the French Cochrane Group and looked at all the data on SU volume outcome relationship. And the short answer is that yes, there is a volume outcome relationship, but also we felt that yes, it can be overcome. So here is our volume outcome relationship. And we build it into our overall Hanabedian conceptual model of structure, process, and outcome. And you can see that it gets complicated. But this is really, these are the different levers, these are different places that we can do health services research. We can look for things that are measurable and associated with quality. So regionalized care for critical care really has this fundamental underpinning of the volume outcome relationship. And then also you will hear about competence and scope and scale. And that actually really translated into more efficient, leaner healthcare delivery processes. Maybe we need an RCT. Sounds great, but where's Dr. Center saying that, where's the data showing me? And we actually have one, which is a really cool paper. I think many of you probably know this, came out in Lancet right when I was graduating from fellowship for my residency. This was the CSER trial where patients were randomized to a center that could provide ECMO or a center that fit in Great Britain. Really impressive work. I would argue that this is actually not a trial of ECMO, this is a trial of regionalized care, because a quarter of the patients that went to center didn't actually get ECMO. So the intervention here was moved into a high capability center. So this is actually an RCT for regionalized care. Here's their the Kaplan-Meier, where you can see that the survival was much better in the patients that were in the ECMO arm and never needed to treat with six. So I would say this is on the level of aspirin. Maybe perhaps a little bit more expensive. And so we looked at this and we said, what in the United States is this possible? Do we have the infrastructure? Do we have the network for these high capability centers, particularly for acute respiratory failure? So this was some work that came out last year where we looked both for ECMO and for advanced mechanical ventilation, high volume mechanical ventilation in the U.S. his fancies, he's in the maps about the Yukon Mountain, which is prominent, but the bottom line is that much of the United States is within a, you know, stone's throw from the center, like, from right to the center, like the one that you're training in. So there's a strong conceptual support. There's precedent in other fields, in neonatal, ICU care, and trauma care, pediatric care. There's empirical evidence from this big Manson paper, and there's a potentially ready infrastructure, but it's actually not happening in the critical care yet. And so I would talk, talking about this today, not because NIFA asked me to give a talk on critical care, but because there are so many clear parallels between what is happening in the ICU space and what is happening in the emergency department. So a lot of my line of research are now kind of pivoting and looking at emergency medicine and looking at the same kinds of things, trying to look at staffing structure and throughput, and looking at capacity and all of these other things that I'm looking at in the ICU space. And I encourage you to contact me because I talked about this today, not to show what I've been up to, but really to have more collaborators because it really is a collaborative effort and it's a cool space. So that was the HSR piece, but then I obviously could go on and on because I would love it. I do that to you. But now I'm going to give you a couple of pearls, some pro tips for coming to Pittsburgh. So this is a Three Rivers area of downtown Pittsburgh. And coming out of this program, I felt, you know, semi-invincible and that I could handle anything that comes to the door. But I was going to the place where you had Peter Saffer and who created CPR, sure who was in Maryland, and then immediately came to Pittsburgh and set up the now famous Saffer Center. And also Aki Prendick, who is one of the luminaries of critical care, founder of CCM, and created the first critical care fellowship. So Dr. Saffer was not there when I went to Pittsburgh, but Aki Prendick still was. And so this is, you know, this is a pretty serious place to go do your training. So here's actually, this was my first night on call at the VA. The picture, you know, I have to take it quickly, otherwise my phone would have been confiscated and I'd be arrested. But this was the first Minnesota tube that I've been in. And so from residency, learning about, we all heard about Blakemore tubes, but we don't use Blakemore tubes anymore. The Minnesota tubes, same thing as I showed those. You can see that this is in for a patient with esophageal varices. Here's another one that I put in. Not too far after that. How many of you have put one of these in? Okay, so some of the hands are from people from the University of Pittsburgh. But here's the pearl. Okay, 50-50 rule. So you're going to put it into 50 centimeters, and you're going to put 50 centimeters, you know, you're going to put 50 of hair in. And the real pearl is to wrap the teeth in gauze, the clamps that you're going to put on, because otherwise they'll eat through the Minnesota tube. Whipping out across the room. So those are really the two pearls. And then because I knew Lethal would be here today, you can also confirm placement using a bubble study. So we did this a couple times in my first year. So it's a nice sum full of blood. It's easy to tell that you're in the right position rather than using chest x-ray. Although I would caution you that the length of the Minnesota tube is 10 centimeters from the tip to the first opening. So you could actually still be in the esophageal gastric junction and still get that. So all right, here is a patient with diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. Interestingly, sometimes these patients come to my unit, I work in the liver transplant unit, they come to us as GI bleeds. This was a patient that was admitted as GI bleed, clearly has just swallowed a lot of blood. And here I'm in the right base, you can see the walls are looking pretty bad. And did the serial dilution, so if you wanna make the diagnosis, because you have potential for giving some pretty hardcore drugs to these people. So serial dilution of 50 milliliters of saline, and if it's coming back like this, you know, you have a major problem. So this is one of the examples of where you put the good lung up. So for many other problems, we put the good lung down to try to improve our VQ matching, try to get the blood to the good side. But here, this would be a problem because you'd have all the blood going to your good side, and now you don't have a good side. The other is the dilution of epinephrine that we use to just spray in there and buy yourself some time. So you take 1 milliliter out of a gray box of epi and add it to 100 of saline, and that's a good starting point. All right, so this is our nitric oxide machine in our unit. Just funny that it says turn the nitric off and it's not to use because it costs $117 an hour. So it's right around $3,000. know, as Susan knows, you'll get called to troubleshoot it. And so you show up and look at this full equipment. So this is an ELAD circuit. So that's an extracorporeal liver assist device. It's going to sound like I'm making this up, but the ELAD device is a system that uses a hepatoblastoma cell line from a 17-year-old boy from Argentina from the 70s that's been maintained in San Diego. I mean, it really sounds like I'm talking about something out of Marvel Comics. But they took this one cell line, purified it, and then put it into here. These are the cartridges that have this hepatoblastoma cell line. So we, have our cartridges, and what are we doing? We're taking the patient's plasma and we're exposing it to a large block of cancer. And then the cancer is going crazy on the plasma. And then we give it back to the patient, hopefully not the cancer, just the plasma. And so this is a liver support device that's put in series with a cancer cell line. So pretty interesting. On the top right, that's a continuous, basically an ADG monitor before and after. It's funny that the Krebs cycle came up before because I know that I remember Dr. Austin telling me about leukocyte varsity, and that's something that I still tell trainees about, this idea that the red blood cells don't have mitochondria, so they're going to convert pyruvate directly to galactate, and that's why when your ABG sits around, galactate goes up. But that the white blood cells, they actually have mitochondria, so they can take advantage of this and move that pyruvate into the TCA cycle. And but what happens then? Oxidative phosphorylation, so all of your oxygen gets wrong. So I remember I was talking to the tech and I said, oh, this is like leukocyte varsity. It was just like blank stare, no idea. So I think leukocyte varsity may be a Brooklyn thing. But what we do with the gas analyzer on the top right of the screen there is supplement glucose and oxygen to the cancer cells because they are, they never sleep, they never stop working, and you don't want to rob the patient of oxygen and glucose. And this is the centrifugal lab. So what is the pearl that I'll give you if you're asked to troubleshoot the ELAD circuit? It's to just ask for help, because this is pretty serious. And this was also from my first year, so that I was laying in the CTICU, looking at the bottom of the mom bed above me. Saw this scrawled in, this sucks. And there were days that it didn't feel that way. Training is really a precious time, and for those of you that are in residency now and are thinking about fellowship, just keep at it, because it's really worth it. So I talked a little bit about HSR and a couple of the Pittsburgh pro tips. So you can see it here, the organizational approaches to critical care, and I would actually say emergency medicine can improve outcomes and improve quality. And that regionalized care, this has tremendous potential as a quality improvement strategy, particularly for time-sensitive medical conditions. And that there are these clear parallels between intensive care and emergency medicine. Obviously, it's the location of the care. That's I would say that even if some is good, more may not be better, more may not be possible. So you have to be creative and think about other solutions. Thank you.
I have the pleasure of introducing our last speaker of the day, who is the director of the New York City Poison Control Center. And I never thought he would have a sugar cookie day. He went to medical school here, he trained here, he did his fellowship at the Poison Control Center, then came back and worked here. And a couple of weeks ago, he set his phone on Waze so he could figure out how to get here. And it sent him in the wrong direction. So even then, he found his way back, which is good for us today. And I'd like to proudly welcome Dr. Mark Sue.
All right. I came at 12:30 today to make sure I was very, very early. All right, Cody, can you read the slide, please? Class of 2000, about sedation in the emergency department, and I want you to remember, or at least try to think about sedation and think about it in quotes. Okay. All right. So I've been so excited about this talk for so long. This is the email from Lonnie Manager, forwarded to me from Bhakti Daisy, it's June, and ever since I got this email, I've been so excited. I've been thinking about this talk pretty much almost every day. So I'm very excited to be here, and I'm so happy to be a part, and I'm so honored to be in front of all of you to celebrate this occasion with you. And then, on 9/25, while I was on my Disney vacation in Alaska, I got this email from NIMBA, saying me and asking about my lecture again. Goofy and having a great time. Wow, this is coming, it's coming, it's so exciting. So we get really pumped. Okay? All right. And then today, you know, I looked at this list of speakers and I was like, totally blown away, like this was. All these distinguished alumni that are going to be here to talk, and I feel so blessed and so happy. And then they had to change the order, put me at the end. All right, we're immersed in medicine and conditions, you got to roll the button, but I got to go with the pump. All right, so we're going to go with the flow. So let's go back. There's some history. So Dr. Lucchese, Dr. Scalia talking about some history back in 1995. They gave you the perspective from the faculty side. Why don't you give the perspective from my side? So 1995, Dr. Lucchese said it. ER was a huge show, a big deal, choir, all these people. George Clooney was first becoming famous. You know, big deal, huge deal.